Germany's Goethe-Institutes, developing dialogue between cultures. How well do we understand each other? In the interview, Klaus-Dieter Lehmann, the president of the Goethe-Institute.
Mr. Lehmann, the Goethe-Institutes just asked Europeans what they like about Germany and what they don't like. It seems right now they're none too fond of us. Spaniards think we're obsessed with food safety, the French say we're too worried about nuclear power, and the Greeks think Germany's tough stand on debt is making their lives difficult. One newspaper said that Europeans admire our perfectionism, but hate our arrogance. Does that match the results of your survey?
The study reveals something completely different, which is remarkable. We asked people what they like about Germany, and in most cases the answer was everything. There were some exceptions, like food, but generally speaking, even we were surprised. Germans are remarkably well regarded among Europeans, and we do enjoy evident popularity in Europe. During times of crisis, people do conjure up boogeymen. Yet in Greece recently, the Goethe-Institute's been full of people wanting to find out about Greek-German relations. For example, how Germany helped Greece during the military dictatorship. So opinions are quite different. We don't have to worry about our reputation, but we do have to work to maintain it.
So we still need Goethe Institutes in Europe. There was a proposal to just concentrate on China and Latin America.
That was an error, as you can see now. Look at Spain's high youth unemployment, or Greece, or Ireland, and it's clear that the ability to withstand stress drops off if the state stops providing funds, and then you're on a downward slope. We can't just view Europe in historical terms because we're at peace now. We need an emotional attachment to Europe. The Goethe Institute's not just about the rational business of providing language classes or information. We provide human ties, human competence, closeness to each other, neighborliness, specific projects, and an opportunity to find out about each other. That's crucial. That's where the Goethe Institute can achieve a lot in Europe.
And around the world, much has changed during the 60 years of the Goethe Institute's work. Where's the current focus?
We are currently very strong in problem countries, where there are dictatorships, corrupt regimes, or where civil society is only in its infancy. That means we're working more strongly in aspects of civil society with an emphasis on the Middle East and North Africa. They're decisive for us now, but so is sub-Saharan Africa. The whole of Southeast Asia and China form another focus, where we have new programs in place. That doesn't mean just presenting cultural events. We're establishing structures. That's our main task in the world right now. And in view of the fact that we don't primarily serve economic interests, but do that without any self-interest through culture, it means we're well-received, credible, and have a secure future.
Is Germany especially credible there?
Yes, that's partly to do with the way the Goethe Institutes are organized. We were founded in 1951, but not as a state corporation. We're an independent legal body. We receive two-thirds of our funding from the German parliament and raise the rest ourselves. We decide what we produce. People around the world watch us closely, and that provides us with credibility.
That obviously goes down well, but are there accusations you're interfering?
No, I believe I can rightly say that our 150 institutes around the world, in some of the most difficult countries, have not been shut down or suffered censorship to hinder our work. That shows clearly that we do not aim to be provocative. It's clear that secret police keep an eye on us, but we're accepted because we're non-political. So we're able to work freely in difficult countries.
Especially so in Tunisia and Egypt, which are changing and building up a civil society from scratch. Syria is a more difficult case, where there's no freedom of information, but where you need certain freedoms.
In Syria, we've had to shut down the Goethe-Institute because of the dangerous situation. We could no longer ensure the safety of our own staff or our local workers. So Syria is a blank on the map for us. In Tunisia and Egypt, we've had a good base because even before the revolutions, we had communities linked to the Goethe-Institutes, communities of people who are now central figures in the movement, young people in the cultural scene, artists and intellectuals. But Syria is a very difficult country. We've tried to create some space there, but the secret police have their tentacles in every niche of society, so it's incredibly difficult. We knew all the censors who didn't make life easy for us, but it was still really tough.
Cultural and educational work is one side of the coin, language is the other at the Goethe-Institute. Is the demise of German as a foreign language inevitable?
No, I think we're doing too little to promote our language. That's also a job for the government. It's not just about providing quality courses at Goethe-Institutes. That's just one element. We have a great success story called Partners for the Future, where we go to local schools and train German teachers or help set up German language departments that provide education up to school leaving age. We have an unbelievable opportunity in India now. We've been asked to set up a German department in 1,000 schools across the country. We've decided to rise to the challenge, starting in 2012. So wherever we invest in the German language, we're successful. That shows we first have to change our own negativity and lack of interest in the German language here at home, before things will improve. We have to fight to keep German as an official EU working language. After all, there are 100 million native speakers and another 100 million non-native speakers of our language.
You've just opened the 150th Goethe-Institute in the capital of Cyprus, Nicosia. What does your map of the world look like? Where do you want to go next?
Nicosia was a special case because it's the last divided capital in Europe. And maybe as Germans, we really do have a special duty to influence divided cities so that they can be reunited. Our new institute straddles the demarcation line between northern and southern Cyprus. So it's quite something to open that kind of center between the barbed wire and watchtowers with UN peacekeepers. We want to work there, but otherwise we'll not be founding new institutes. On the whole, we expect the Goethe-Institute to be well served in the future with 150 centers, reading rooms, and contact points. We'll be intensifying work on our current program and major themes like our German Year projects, but not necessarily opening new institutes.
Thank you for joining us.
My pleasure.